Hey Nick, how are you doing this afternoon?
Doing great, Dave. How are you?
I am doing well. I am doing well.
Another
And
Friday, another
another Friday.
podcast. We got a
Yep.
good one today. We're getting charitable, right?
That's right. We're going to talk about charitable giving strategies. And for a lot of our clients, this has been an interesting topic the last couple of years because the way they had handled charitable giving for years changed in terms of how they treated on their taxes. And it's caused some frustration and a lot of questions. And it, I think, makes sense for us to talk a little bit about some of the simple strategies people can do to fulfill their charitable goals and yet still get some tax benefits from it.
Yeah, absolutely. We have lots of clients that enjoy giving to charity as part of their financial strategy. And so we definitely want to support that and find the best way to do that. And getting tax deductions is a part of that. But like you said, there's been some changes. So you got to be a little bit more conscientious of how you do that.
Right. So, for context, traditionally you make donations during the year, you save your receipts, and then when you do your taxes, you total those up and you add to it certain things that are also deductible, like certain healthcare costs and mortgage interest and property taxes, things like that. And historically, folks in the middle class would, in a lot of years, have enough to get over the standard deduction on their taxes.
Yeah, I
And
mean, it used to be it wasn't very hard. If you had a mortgage and you had a pretty decent amount of state and local income taxes, you were usually at or about to that point.
right.
But that all kind of changed with the tax law change.
Right. And it's not that the deductions themselves changed. You're still allowed to deduct your charitable giving. However, the standard deductions went up quite a bit so that now in 2021, for a single taxpayer, the deduction is $12,550. And for a married couple, it's $25,100. So you've got to have quite a bit of mortgage interest and property tax and deductions to get to that hurdle. And if you're just doing donations of a few hundred dollars here or there, you probably aren't going to get any tax benefit from them.
Right. And so it went from like 40%, I believe, somewhere around there of people that were not taking or taking the standard deduction up to like 85% of people now take the
Right,
standard deduction.
right.
And so, that has a big impact on your ability to write off your charitable contributions, like we
Right,
talked about. Most
right,
people aren't itemizing anymore.
right, right. And while most people that I've talked to still are still making donations and being charitably minded, some of that incentive has gone away a little bit. And so one of the things that was adjusted here last year as part of the CARES Act was to allow for a $300 charitable deduction, regardless of whether you itemize or not. And this year for 2021, that will be $300 for single taxpayers and $600 if you file jointly.
Yeah, and I think kind of the thought process behind making these above the line deductions, if you will, which means that you don't have to itemize, is that charity's really gotten to a lot of trouble as far as their ability to generate income during the pandemic as well. And so this was one easy way to that the government decided that they could incentivize people to give and to gift,
Right.
because they knew that they were going to get a deduction on their taxes. They didn't have to do anything. They didn't
Right.
have to itemize in order to be able to do this.
So our first strategy is just to keep in mind that the first $300 if you're single or $600 if you're filing jointly on your tax return is deductible regardless of whether you get over the $12,550 or $25,100 level. You can still take that limited deduction. So keep your receipts, and if you give $50 a month to your church, that's $600, and that would be deductible, or $100 to the local food pantry, you know, that you still are going to get some advantage from that. So that was a nice change. And yeah, as you said, it was to help charities like food banks and the like during the pandemic, but they've kind of put it in as a permanent thing for now. Nothing in taxes is permanent, right? But
right, yeah. And you know, it's a decent deal. You know, it's on a smaller dollar amount, but if you're in the 22% tax bracket and you give $100, that's 22 mm-hmm. that you're not paying in taxes. So it's not, yep. you know, it's not bad at all.
Yeah. Yeah. Or, you know, another way to look at it is that it saves you 22 cents on the dollar for every, you know, it gives you that much more ability to give and support than you would otherwise. You're doing it at right. a lower cost. So,
right.
So another strategy that you can use to make donations and get some tax benefit from it is to group your giving into 1 year if you can. Mm-hmm. So it takes a little more planning and it takes having some savings available, but you can recoup some of that tax benefit. So...
Yeah. So, you know, a common maybe example or an easy to understand example is, you know, if you are making regular donations that you're going to make them irregardless, something like a tithe to your church. And let's say that amount is $10,000 a year. Well, if you had the ability to take $10,000 that you were going to give in 1 year and do all of it in January and then continue on your monthly amount throughout the year, as opposed to doing it in two separate years, sometimes that will help you get over that threshold of the mm-hmm. standard deduction.
Mm-hmm. Yep. And, you know, that was, you know, $10,000 a year is maybe on the extreme side, but even if it's a couple thousand a year and you add those together, because you're trying to get over that standard deduction hurdle. So right. once you get over either the $12,500 or the $25,000 level, it starts to do you some good. So that's one way. Again, you know, requires some planning and some forethought. And I had one client, we talked about that strategy, and she said, well, but my church is used to me giving X every month. And I said, you know what? I bet if you call the church secretary and tell them yeah. you're going to do 3 years all at once, they'll be okay with that.
Right.
Yeah. You know, so it takes a little planning and it's a little different than what we're used to, but, you know, it can be done. It can be done.
Absolutely.
You know, the next strategy to talk about, and this has been very popular amongst our retired clients, but qualified charitable distributions from IRAs.
Yeah. So these are really neat, because a lot of times when you are at that required minimum distribution age, you've got to take money out of these accounts irregardless. And so when you're 72, you have to take a required minimum distribution. And so if you are also giving to charity as it is, outside of your IRA on a regular basis, it's just kind of a matter of switching up how you do that. And instead of doing it out of your income, if you do it out of your IRA, it allows you to make that distribution from your IRA and not pay the taxes on it. And if you have, and it accounts for your required minimum distribution, which is
right.
super helpful, because you had right. to take this money and you have to take more income. Well, now you're doing the charitable donations, but you're not taking on the income.
Right. And it doesn't matter if you itemize, because it just doesn't count as income. So, you know, it's a direct benefit to you. And you have to be over age 70 and a half, and you have to have the check made out directly to the charity. So you have to work with your custodian and your financial planners to make sure that it's documented right and done correctly. But, you know, the limit now is quite high. It's up to $100,000 per IRA holder. So a husband and a wife could each do $100,000 out of separate accounts. Pretty generous benefit, and I think that's one we're going to keep seeing be popular.
Yeah, and I think too, you know, the benefit of the higher standard deduction is if you're making charitable contributions and you're not getting above that standard deduction, this is a way to still use that standard deduction
Right.
and use those charitable contributions because you're not taking that income that you would have
Right.
had to take in your IRA. So that can be a big benefit too.
Right. And again, it's a different mindset. We've had people that would normally write a $100 check to an organization. Instead, in January or February, we'll do a $1,200 IRA check to that organization. And again, the organizations love it because they're getting the money up front.
Right.
And, it's actually easier for them. So
Right. Yeah, absolutely.
haven't had any recipients yet come back and say, boy, we wish
Right.
you'd go back to $100 a month instead.
Right.
So and so another strategy that can be effective is to donate appreciated assets instead of cash. So in a nutshell, if you've got stock, for instance, that you bought a long time ago and it's gone up in value, if you sell that stock yourself and give cash to a charity, you're going to pay capital gains on that growth.
Right.
If you donate shares of stock to a charity, they can sell the stock and they don't pay any capital gains tax.
Right. Yeah, so that can be a big benefit depending on how long you've owned the stock, how much appreciation you have, but that can make a big difference.
And the donation itself may still be tax deductible if you get above the standard deduction amount, but even if it's a smaller amount, you're at least getting that capital gains liability out of your own portfolio. So there's some benefit there.
Absolutely.
And it's a fairly simple process. Most nonprofits that I've asked about this have an account somewhere where they can
Right.
receive a gift of stock or mutual funds, and they have a broker that is on that account that will liquidate those funds when they come in and provide the cash back to the charity, usually at a nice reduced commission, the ones that I've seen. So.
Yeah, and if they don't, I'm sure that they would be willing to set one up in most cases to be able to do this. I'm sure it's they're looking for lots of different ways to get donations, so
They're not going
they'll
to turn
find a
you down.
way. Yeah.
So, just ask if you're thinking about supporting an organization and you're not sure, just ask whomever your contact is there. Chances are they've got the ability to receive appreciated assets, or they'll figure it out one way or the other. So that's another strategy that's available to just about everybody. Donor advised funds is another possibility. And this is kind of neat. It requires planning again, but it allows you to both group contributions into 1 year and potentially use that appreciated asset approach that we just talked about. Easy for me to
Right.
say, right?
Yeah. So, the benefit of these is you can make that contribution all in 1 year, right? So, let's say you've got a pile of cash and you're planning on being charitable with it. But, depending on where you're at, you might not want to give all that cash to charity right now, but you want to earmark it for the future. And so you take that and you put it into a donor advised fund. You realize that deduction in the year that you give it, and then you set up the donor advised fund to then be able to give that money to charity at your discretion throughout the years based on what you when you that need arises that you want to give it away.
You're essentially then making grants from your own little foundation in a way. So yeah, you can make a $20,000 grant to your foundation from your assets, take that deduction this year, and then give it two charities, $1,000 here, $500 there. And these accounts are really a partnership between you and a foundation, a nonprofit of some sort, to make it work for tax purposes. So you've got to be aware they're all going to have rules and minimums and different caveats. The ones I've looked at are all pretty easy to work with, but you just kind of need to do a little research and make sure it makes sense. There's some neat ideas available with donor advised funds, particularly for families, because you can have your family be the committee that you know, gets together to decide how they're going to use a certain amount of the money every year, which I think is kind of neat, especially if you've got, you know, young adult children that may be interested, or, you know, there's some interesting things you can do there from a family perspective.
Yeah, they're you know, relatively new, but they're becoming more and more commonplace, and you know, they're pretty easy to set up. And like you said, Dave, as long as you do some due diligence on what exactly the rules are and making sure that you're doing it right, they can be a pretty nice tool to use if you've got a chunk of money that you want to donate, but you don't necessarily want it to go right now to a charity, but you want to donate it over time, and or you want to involve your family in some of that stuff. I mean, there's a lot of ways that you can set those up
and make those decisions on an ongoing basis instead of our original grouping strategy, which is just a group one donation, you know, to one charity in several years. You can spread it out this way, and you can also fund a donor advised fund with appreciated assets, so you know, you can you can get that tax benefit there too. So also, you know, we'd be remiss not to mention that community foundations can set up programs similar to donor advised funds, and sometimes that may be a simpler and more effective choice, depending on, again, they all have their own rules, and so the same caveats apply. You need to check into what the minimums are and how, you know, how restrictive they are in terms of how you donate that money when you're ready.
Yeah, and definitely, you know, do your due diligence around what kind of fees they're going to charge, what the processes are, make sure that you're comfortable with the people that are running these. Because they're not all created equal, but there's, you know, we've got some great ones in our area that do a fantastic job, and we have worked with them in the past. So there are some really good ones out there for sure.
Yeah, and that can be a very good choice. So the last thing we're going to talk about today is, you know, you can also do charitable giving strategies using your beneficiary designations on your accounts. And, you know, you can essentially name a charity as the contingent beneficiary on your IRA or even primary beneficiaries. And that has some tax advantages, because if you leave that money to a family member, if it's a tax deferred IRA or an annuity, they're going to have to pay the tax on that when they take the money out. But a nonprofit can receive those funds, take them out of the account, and not pay tax.
Yeah, so this is, you know, it comes with a little bit of planning, but, you know, other things being equal, if you want a part of your estate when you pass to go to a charity, there's some better things to give to a charity than there might be to give to kids. So, you know, if my parents were to pass and they had a bunch of money in a Roth IRA versus a traditional IRA, and they wanted to give some to me and some to charity, well, I'm asking for the Roth, and I'm telling them to give the IRA to charity, because that we're both going to get the same amount if there's the same amount in there. The difference is neither of us will be paying taxes if I get the Roth IRA and they get the traditional IRA. And so there's some planning around there that makes a lot of sense depending on who your beneficiaries are and what your desire is in terms of the amounts that you want to give and who you want to give to.
Yeah. So, you know, the bottom line there is talk with your advisor, your financial planner, or your estate planning attorney about what you're trying to accomplish in terms of how much you'd like to support different entities, and they'll help you figure out the best, most efficient way to do that. Because there's different answers for different scenarios, depending on how much you have in IRAs and Roth IRAs and after-tax accounts. There's all kinds of different combinations. So those are our simple charitable giving strategies. There's a whole host of complicated estate planning tools you can use as well, that involve different trusts and annuity structures and are usually designed around getting money out of an estate for estate tax purposes.
Yeah, I mean, you can really get into the weeds, and that's certainly not what the purpose of this podcast is, but there's some, you know, some really smart people out there, and you know, the tax code is complicated, and when you put those two things together, you get some really great, very cool strategies, but they're also complex and not right for everyone. But certainly if you are curious about what those are, reach out to us or reach out to a local estate planning attorney, because there's lots of different ways out there to maximize what you're giving to charity and maximize the tax savings benefit that you get.
Right. So I hope this helps clear up some of the questions around simpler charitable giving strategies. But, you know, we're always here to help. If you have questions, drop us a line.
Absolutely. Yeah, this has been great. There's lots of things that you can do to donate to charity. And the one thing I'll say in kind of closing is, even if you don't get a tax deduction, there are very few people in my life that I have met that said, man, I wish I didn't support this charity, or I wish I didn't give back in some way, shape, or form. So please don't let that fact that you might not get a tax benefit stop you from supporting some of the really great nonprofits that we have out there.
Yeah. Just like we say with the portfolio choices, taxes are important, but you can't let taxes wag the tax tail wag the investment or the gifting strategy dog, so to speak. Right.
Absolutely. So, absolutely.
All right. Well, it's been fun as always.
Yeah. Thanks, Dave. This is great.
All right. I'll talk to you later.
Until next time.